pretty flowers. Your eyes in stars above. It's just the thought of you, the very thought of you, my love.
Got quiet here.
I think they're expecting you to say something. Yeah.
Well, they just sent me a signal to wait. People walking in. You got some more coming? Okay. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. My name is Skip Rutherford. I'm Dean of the Clinton School, and we welcome you to another in a great series of programs. We're proud to sponsor this along with MacArthur Military Museum and with the National Archives and the Clinton Presidential Library. There's my friend Brad. Brad, congratulations. I just read about you today. Could I ask everyone please to turn your cell phones and other electronic devices off? Arkansas has a long history with presidents. You know, when I was growing up, I never thought I would ever meet a president. And then after one came from Arkansas, it seems like now everybody from Arkansas is running for president, which is a good thing. And I got to say, a native daughter of Arkansas is doing, I think, one heck of a job speaking for a president. And I think Sarah Huckabee Sanders has a tough job, and she's doing, I think, a great job. So with that, let me say that we're glad to have you here, and I appreciate the co-sponsorship of NARA, the Presidential Library, and MacArthur Military Museum. So I'd like to introduce my friend Kathleen Pate, who's the education specialist with the Clinton Presidential Library. The interesting thing is, Kathleen started in 2002, and we didn't open the Clinton Library until 2004, but those of us who were working on it were deeply involved in the planning, and she started the educational programming and the outreach 2 years before it opened. So she's been on this job for almost 15 years, and really runs one of the finest presidential library education programs in the country. So please welcome Kathleen Pate.
Well, I know that you're not here to see me this evening, but I did want to say that we're delighted to be partnering with the Clinton School and to have this program here tonight in Sturgis Hall, and to also be partnering with the MacArthur Museum of Arkansas Military History. I'm going to turn it over to Stephen McAteer, who's the director there, in just a moment. But I do want to thank you all for being here today. President Roosevelt spoke with school children this morning, and they were delighted to meet him and peppered him with all kinds of interesting questions. So I hope that you will do the same at the conclusion of the program. And I just want to thank you all for being here. And I'm going to turn it over to Stephen McAteer, my friend, who was at one point my boss when I was a lowly grad student at the UALR Public History Program. I'm glad to have him as a colleague and as a friend, Stephen McAteer.
Thank you, Kathleen. It's always a pleasure to work with you on these partnerships. I want to thank the Clinton Presidential Library and the school. Kathleen and I have known one another for 20 years or so, and yes, she was a graduate assistant for me for about a year, but we're only about 2 or 3 years apart in the public history program, so I just got a job and she needed some experience and they placed her there, which hopefully that did a great job of preparing you for coming over here. But we enjoy the partnerships that we have with her and the Clinton Library, and then other partnerships that we have with her and other organizations, and we do appreciate them hosting this event tonight. We also want to thank the Arkansas World War I Centennial Commemoration Committee for sanctioning this event and helping us to promote it. And before I get into our special guests that all of you came to listen to, I would be remiss if I didn't at least mention someone who is actually not here tonight. When we envisioned this program, it was going to be a debate. It was going to be an evening with two presidents. We were going to have Woodrow Wilson come and debate Theodore Roosevelt on American involvement in World War I. We had a really good contact with someone who has an uncanny resemblance to Woodrow Wilson out of Virginia. Unfortunately, 2 weeks ago, he contacted me and had emergency surgery and could not make it. But the upside of that is that we get Teddy Roosevelt alter ourselves tonight, and I believe me, he can feel the time that we make available to him. So we hope to get Woodrow Wilson here. Not that I'm saying the president is long-winded, but he came to do a program for us in 2011, so I am somewhat familiar with him. Our guest tonight has an impressive resume that includes the New York City Police Commissioner, Assistant Secretary to the Navy, a hero of the Spanish-American War, Governor of New York, Vice President of the United States, and upon the untimely assassination of William McKinley, he ascended and became the youngest president in our country's history at the age of 42. And that's, of course, Theodore Roosevelt. On this date, this very date, October 25th in 1905, President Roosevelt became only the second sitting president to visit our state and our city. I know none of you were here back then, but he came and was well received in our state and in our city. He spoke to a crowd of about 35,000 people in what was then City Park, what is now MacArthur Park, the home to our institution. And we were very proud to host Teddy Roosevelt then, and we were delighted to welcome him back. So please join me in giving a bully welcome to the 26th President of the United States, Theodore Roosevelt.
Bully, Mr. McAteer. Thank you kindly. Stephen McAteer. Bully. Bully. Oh, I am Theodore Roosevelt, and I'm delighted to be back in Little Rock, Arkansas. I like what you've done with the place. In all earnestness, if there's anything that you take away from our brief time here this evening, anything perchance in the way of entertainment or inspiration, I dedicate our hour together to the men and women of the United States Armed Forces and to our veterans. And this evening, I would also say, these young men here, raise your hands, University of Arkansas Forestry students. Tonight as well, I dedicate the performance to all who fight the fires. Hear, hear. We remember all who serve, especially here at the School of Public Service. Here at the library this morning, how delighted I was to visit with the most important crop in Arkansas, your little ones. How it did my heart good. They've been learning Arkansas and American history. They recognized me. They said, "Good morning, Mr. President," and "Hello, Teddy." One bright student knew that in my retirement, I prefer to be called by my old military title, Colonel. For my brief time in the 1st United States Volunteer Cavalry. History remembers us as the Rough Riders in the cause of Cuba Libre. All of those greetings, historically accurate, stand in such stark contrast to the one young man that saw me sprinting across the lot here this evening. He pointed at me and told his friends, he said, "Look, there's the Monopoly dude." Quite disappointing for a former president, I assure you. And if he knew his history as well as the students in this building, he would have known I was the anti-monopoly dude. The great trust buster. Oh, there are some progressives in Arkansas. Well, I am delighted to be here, and I would like the students to know that while I served as your president for 7 1/2 years, that the second duty I had in public service that lasted the longest was to be the United States Civil Service Commissioner. Appointed by the Republican, President Benjamin Harrison, I fought corruption in his own and my own Republican Party, doing so well that the Democrat, Grover Cleveland, reappointed me. And then I fought corruption in the Democratic regime just as well. Those were 6 years serving as your United States Civil Service Commissioner. Of course, including more people under the protection of civil service, hiring federal employees based upon qualifications and examinations rather than to the victor goes the spoils, political plunder. Of course, that act is famous in American history as the Pendleton Act, named for Congressman George Pendleton, vice presidential candidate for the Democracy in 1864 with General McClellan's nomination. The Pendleton Act created the United States Civil Service Commission, probably the greatest legacy of that public servant, George Pendleton. Of course, George Pendleton was a married man. He married a young lady named Alice Key. Her father was Francis Scott Key, who gave us the national anthem. Might we acknowledge history and acknowledge those who serve and acknowledge our common heritage? Could we stand and sing the Star Spangled Banner this evening? I never visited a town when the brass band didn't come out. Let's stand. Let's sing that great national anthem. The colors are here, and you know the words. I hope your grandchildren know them, too. Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. Bully for Little Rock. Well done. I have not heard that song sung more beautifully in any community throughout the country during this last year of travels. I was but the second president, a sitting president, to visit Arkansas when I came in 1905. I'd been touring the country. I'd been on holiday. Good citizens, when I was your president and I went on vacation, I did not go golfing. I went hunting and camping. That trip in 1905 started in San Antonio. We had the Rough Rider reunion there that year. In 1900, when I saw the nomination for the vice presidency coming, I told the boys that after Oklahoma City, that we shouldn't have a reunion again. It would get involved in politics, but by 1904, I'd been elected in my own right and had announced that I would not be seeking office again in 1908. I did not see how any political benefit could come from me, from the men of the Southwest gathering again to relive the glory of July 1898 in the cause of Cuba Libre. And on that vacation in 1905, I went hunting on the King Ranch in Texas. I hunted with Quanah Parker and Jack Wolfman Abernathy in Oklahoma. I guess I was all hunted out by the time I came to Little Rock. But I must admit, I think I did a bit of hunting when I spoke at City Park. For your governor, Jeff Davis, unbeknownst to me, in making his introductory remarks that day, he spoke in favor of lynching. I'd seen lynching and vigilanteism during my days as a young cowboy and cattle rancher along the Little Missouri River. I dispensed with much of what I'd prepared to say that day. And while my remarks were extemporaneous that October 25th, 1905, at City Park, I thought a portion of those remarks important enough to make sure that I got them properly recorded. There were 35,000 people in City Park that day. And as I shared with some of the gentlemen here, of course, those in the back row, they couldn't have heard me, Mr. DePippa, when I made my speech, but that afternoon, because of the stenographers who sat in the front row, they could read the speech in the afternoon newspaper. And they read in part these words that I spoke to Governor Davis. And above all other men, Governor, you and I, and all who are exponents and representatives of the law, owe it to the cause of civilization and humanity to do everything in our power, officially and unofficially, directly and indirectly, to free the United States from the menace and reproach of lynch law. You may know that in October of 1901, but weeks after I'd become your president, I spent a day working on issues of Southern education and improvement with a man probably with greater expertise on the issues than any other man in the country. And that night, when I had Booker T. Washington, the president of Tuskegee University, as my dinner guest at the White House, you might realize it was the first time that a man of color had had supper with the president as an official guest at the White House. The following day, Southern senators and newspapers and many here in Arkansas were livid, and I was rebuked for my lack of sensitivity to Southern customs and mores. Poppycock. I've never met a man or a woman and judged him or her based on his or her race, color, creed, or religion. You judge an individual by his or her character and actions. And by his character and actions, Booker T. Washington had shown himself the equal of any American. We've come a long way. We've got a long way to go. You may wonder why I'm back 112 years after my historic visit. Now, more than a century after my own presidency, and some of the smarter students know, nearly a century after my own corporal demise. Well, first, of course, Mr. McAteer is quite talented. He dug me up. Always good at the spade work. But there's a pernicious rumor about. There is no truth in it. We must dispel it. It is not true that I've come back to life because former Vice President Cheney needs a hunting lesson. I've come back to celebrate the good and the great things about this country, and there's nothing greater than what's being done at the William Jefferson Clinton Presidential Library and Museum and at this wonderful Clinton School of Public Service. To think that the young people here are learning and answering the call to public service. I heard that call as a young man myself. Imagine my family. They were quite surprised. I had been attending law school at Columbia. With deference to the members of the bar that might be amongst us, I was quite frustrated at law school, where I discovered that rather than teaching a lawyer to fight for righteousness and justice, at law school, a lawyer is taught to fight for a good outcome for his client, regardless whether the outcome is truly righteous or just. Now, that's probably the way the teaching and the practice of law needs to be, but it's not the way I wanted to spend my life professionally. So each and every day, marching between home and Columbia Law School, I passed the local Republican headquarters. Not surprisingly, above the local saloon. And much to the horror of my family, I inquired about becoming involved, was embraced by the young men there, and at the age of 23, I was elected the youngest member of the New York General Assembly. And as I left for Albany that late December to take the oath of office, the erroneous words of one of my cousins were still ringing in my ears. He said, "Theodore, don't you understand the Greek etymology of the word, politics? Poly meaning many, and ticks being blood-sucking insects." But from that age of 23 on until my own demise at the age of 60, I hope that my life was a life of public service, and I'm inspired to be here and to see this young forestry class. Mr. Pilkey, I promised you a story about Pinchot, if I may. We're celebrating conservation. We're also commemorating the centennial of America's entry into the First World War. A war that we could not have fought to the degree that we did without the cooperation and the leadership of the wood products industry. How do you make the rifles? How do you make the crates to ship the weaponry and such? So indeed, the foresters, many of them were regarded as being crucial to the supply of our... So not a many a forester was able to get out of the forest and into the war, but the duty that they did was just as important. My favorite forester, of course, Gifford Pinchot. When we created the United States Forest Service in 1905, the Transfer Act, so titled because we transferred the department from the Bureau of, from the Department of the Interior, where the Bureau of Forestry had been a small bureau staffed by a handful of clerks who'd never seen a board foot of lumber in their lifetimes. Under Gifford Pinchot, we now had the first formally trained scientific forester at the head of the Forest Service, and we transferred to the Agriculture Department. And Pinchot and I had a long relationship prior to the presidency. When I was the governor of New York, Pinchot came to Albany to discuss some forest good. When he rounded the corner on the street to the executive mansion, he witnessed me lowering the Roosevelt children out of a third floor window on bed sheets tied together from a rope, for we were under attack by Indians. I take it I was taking a break from my duties as governor at this point. And Pinchot and I, before we discussed forest good, we went up to my office. We moved all of the furniture to the side walls. We rolled out a wrestling mat. We proceeded to box and to wrestle. Now, Pinchot, like you, Professor Pilkey, is a tall man with a long reach. He bragged for the rest of his career that he knocked the future president off his pins. But I ask you, who do you think won the wrestling match? So to all who serve, I give thanks. I know that the program has it that both Ms. Pate and Mr. McAteer will be asking me questions. They're going to ask short questions, and they've asked me my best to give short answers. Well, good luck with that. Before we, and then we'll take some questions from the audience as well. But I should check with my host to see how much longer might I speechify before we get into the dialogue. You remind me, though, when you made your remarks, someone made their remarks about the length at which the president spoke. I spoke in Fargo recently. It was there, famously, in 1910 that I told the people of Fargo I would have never been president but for my experiences along the Little Missouri as a cattle rancher in my youth. The newspaper wrote up the performance the next day. Now, there was a nice lady who sang. The reporter reported that the lady sung a wonderful program and Theodore Roosevelt made a long speech. Well, so, in case there are members of the Fourth Estate here, I want to make sure, not to make sure that the write-up says make a long speech. Could we get into that dialogue? Why don't we, Mr. McAteer?
Okay, when you were here in 1905, you spoke extemporaneously on current events. I know it's hard for any of us to realize that that would be you, but we thought it would be interesting tonight for us to ask you questions and you to speak on current issues.
I think that's delightful.
So I have one question, and Ms. Pate has a question, and then we're going to open it up to the audience for them to come up with questions.
Delightful.
Okay.
Unless you just like to box or wrestle. Kathleen is ready.
Come on. Okay, Mr. Please. President, this is my question, my one question
the
to you.
The floor is yours, Mr. McAteer.
Thank you. Well, no, the floor is yours. We're celebrating the centennial of American involvement in World War I. Now, 100 years ago, 1917, this time we had been involved, our country had been involved for about 6 months.
Indeed, the first casualties in action occurred just about a century ago to this date.
But the Great War had been raging in Europe for over 3 years at this time. Now, knowing that historians are scoundrels, let's engage in the what-if game.
Ah, the contrapositive.
Yes. What if you had won the election in 1912? I know you don't like to think about that, but if you had
I like thinking about winning it. Reliving the defeat is not much fun.
If you had won that election, how do you think your leadership might have impacted both the outbreak of war and the timing of American entry in World War I?
If I may, Mr. McAteer, if I were elected president in 1912, I don't believe there would have been a First World War, not under the circumstances and conditions that we know it in history. Now, that's quite a contrapositive. There's some who say that the system of alliances, Germany and Austria-Hungary, the Balkan states, Russia with the French and the English, that it was bound to be. Well, of course, some thought that war would come a decade earlier, when the Germans and the French almost went to arms over Morocco. And I helped to assist the Algeciras Conference, which was one of the first arbitrations of an issue, causus belli, that instead was arbitrated with settlement over who took what portion of French and German and Spanish Morocco. But of course, I think the worst thing was that not being president in 1912, the difference between me and Wilson, I think, is stark. The Lusitania was sunk in 1915. The loss of hundreds of American lives, many women and children. President Wilson's response? To send a letter of protest to the Kaiser via the German embassy. I ask you, Mr. Schmidt, if you were walking down the street here in Little Rock and some criminal attacked Mrs. Schmidt, would your response be to send that fellow a letter? You'd stand up and you'd raise your fist and protect the honor and life of your missus. President Wilson said, a people can be too proud to fight. Oh, I believe in peace. Peace is a goddess. But given a choice between peace and righteousness, I choose righteousness. For peace is a goddess who comes with sword girt on thigh. I wish I could have been president, and lacking being president, I wanted to serve. My friends in Congress passed a resolution stating that Colonel Roosevelt should be allowed to command a division of cavalry and lead that cavalry across the fields of France and into the German machine guns. Come to think of it, perhaps those weren't my friends that voted that resolution. I went to the White House to claim my commission, and President Wilson looked at me and through me and said, "President Roosevelt, we now have professional soldiers to do that sort of thing." As I left the White House that day, I turned to Colonel House, President Wilson's military aide. I said, "Doesn't he realize that I just offered to leave my life in France for my country?" And Colonel House said, "Did you make that entirely clear to him?" It was my youngest son, Quentin, that said it was rather up to us to do what father preaches. All four boys entered the war, my son Kermit joining the British forces early just to get into the war as soon as he could, fighting in Mesopotamia. My daughter Ethel rushed off to Paris, as did Ted Jr.'s wife, Eleanor. Not Eleanor Roosevelt. Those of you that have seen the Ken Burns series understand the difference between Ted Jr.'s wife and Cousin Franklin's wife, my niece. I wanted to go and fight, but could not do so. So I supported the war effort, helped to sell Liberty bonds and advocate war loans, and spoke out vociferously against the foe in our own household, hyphenated Americanism. German Americans and Irish Americans who felt more loyalty to their home country or despised the British Empire so much that they did not pull their fair share of the weight or cast stones at the war effort here at home. Of course, hence then, during the war, the Sedition Act, of course, Eugene Debs, the socialist running for president from a federal penitentiary in Atlanta. Times were difficult during that time, and difficult for me not to play a more effective role. I knew that my duty as a citizen was to be on the front lines, but I imagine since I was 58 years old, blind in one eye, gammy in one leg, and perhaps just a pound or two overweight, well, maybe Wilson was in the right, but of course my boys served with distinction. And my boy Quentin, on July 14th, Bastille Day, 1918, was shot and killed over the Second Battle of the Marne. He was recognized by the Germans behind whose lines he crashed, given a funeral with full military honors. When the Allies won the ground, already by that time, his propeller had been placed as a cross above his grave, and his gravesite became a point of pilgrimage as the soldiers went to the front. And it was July 1918. That fall, the gardener at Sagamore Hill came into the barn, and there found me with my arms around Quentin's pony, crying into the neck of that pony, "Poor Quinnikins, poor Quinnikins." But I publicly said that it was terribly serious to know that as a father I'd given advice to my son that had caused my son to take action leading to his own death, but that it was better that Quentin had served and died than if he hadn't served at all. In the war year of 1918, the village of Bismarck, Pennsylvania, changed its name to Quentin, Pennsylvania. And after the war, the Quentin Roosevelt American Legion post rose along the banks of the Fox River outside of Chicago, Illinois. I was dead by January 6th, 1919, dying of what the doctors called a coronary embolism, a blood clot in the lung. I would imagine, though, I probably also died from a broken heart. 130,000 plus men gave their lives from the United States of America, a paltry sum compared to what the Europeans had done murdering one another. Nearly 1,000 of those young men came from Arkansas, and we celebrate all who serve, and most especially those who sacrifice the greatest sacrifice. But to come full round, we must study our history. We must know it and embrace it and not hide it away someplace because it makes us uncomfortable. I spoke out against lynching 112 years ago in this very city. In 1919, when the African-American soldier came back from Europe, he was very often found chastised. And there were a number of lynchings, probably a record number, in 1919, 1920, including, as the Arkansas people know, a terrible set of lynchings and race riots in the village of Elaine, Arkansas, in 1919. We are here to keep history alive. It's not always pretty, but it's our history. It's American history. I'm concerned about what's happening with history these days, rewriting it, revisionism. It is what it is, and it was what it was. And here, nearby, where almost the flame of civil war broke out in February of 1861, at the very museum and on the very grounds of the arsenal that was located here, that's your history, Little Rock. And how honored I was in 1905 that my honor guard, were composed of men who wore the gray and the blue. We'd come together again beneath the red, white, and blue. And let us not fall into sectionalism or classism or any sort of movement in this country that would tear us apart. Let us look to the history that we've had and come together again beneath the red, white, and blue and remember those who serve in this war and those who gave their lives a century ago in the Great War, erroneously called the war to end all wars. We should have known better. Mr. McAteer or Ms. Pate?
It's my turn.
Oh, delightful. Fair play now. You've been waiting for this all day.
I have. Well, I'd like to hear your views on women's suffrage.
Oh, wonderful.
Now, 1917, about a month from now, 1917, the women of New York State, I suppose the men of New York State voted
well
to allow the women of New York State to have the vote, but it would be three more years. You wouldn't actually live to see the passage of the 19th Amendment. But I understand that you maybe were an early supporter, and I'd like to hear a little bit more about that.
I thank you for calling me an early supporter, for I really was a Johnny-come-lately. Women's suffrage had been advocated, of course, since the equality state of Wyoming had first adopted female suffrage. I finally advocated female suffrage in 1912 when I embraced the progressive nomination. Of course, as president, I could have probably done a great deal more to advance women's suffrage with what I called the bully pulpit of the White House. But it was in 1912, and I think perhaps for political advantage, that when my nomination was seconded by Jane Addams, the great social reformer of Chicago's Whole House, at that Progressive Party convention, that, of course, I knew that women's suffrage being a part of the progressive platform, unlike the two major parties, that it might give us some advantage in what would hopefully be a very close contest, and one that I really fully expected to win at the onset of the campaign. So, of course, I knew many of the great suffragettes, all of those, many of course, the whole movement was birthed in New York, the Seneca Falls movement, Frederick Douglass, of course, being an advocate of women's suffrage as well, that man of Rochester, New York. So I was a bit progressive, but I also was a bit late in the effort to come about to women's suffrage. My own idea was that it was probably the right thing to do, but that it wasn't very important. I actually believed, again, because of the structure of most American households at the time, that the spouse would simply vote the way that the husband voted. Of course, we know better now, don't we? I'm looking out here. There's many a canceled ballot sitting next to each other here tonight, I'm sure. I hope that was at length enough.
Yeah,
all right. You've got the follow-up if you'd like.
Of a way to put you on the spot, but I don't know what it would be.
Those children surely did today, didn't they?
They did. They had a lot of
little
questions.
Little whippersnappers.
And I suspect that our audience has a lot of questions. So rather than a follow-up, I think we can take some questions from the floor.
Oh, he's loaded for bear. You knew already that he was practicing on the way here, wasn't he? Sir, would you do us the honor of standing up and introducing yourself that we all might know you?
I'm Jake Tidmore. I sometimes work with Stevens.
Oh, fantastic.
He didn't tell me to ask.
Jake, what's your last name?
Tidmore.
How do you spell
T-I-D-M-O-R-E.
it?
T-I-D-M-O-R-E.
Now I've got it, Mr. Tidmore.
Thank you.
You know, I'm from New York. I could use a translator here in Arkansas on occasion.
Be glad.
Mr. Tidmore, your question or comment?
Yes, sir. There has been some controversy regarding condolences to families.
Right.
And rather than asking you to speak about the controversy, if you don't wish, what words of comfort would you give to the families, to the widows, to the mothers, to the fathers and the sons of these people?
I think remarks to the family are probably best made in writing, made with consideration. You might remember there's a famous letter from Abraham Lincoln sent to a mother who'd given four sons, I believe, in the cause of the Civil War. His letter was eloquent, speaking about how those sons had given their life on the altar of liberty. Well, of course, now the president's pressed for time, phone calls are made. Well, I use the telephone myself a good deal as president. Was the first president to have a telephone in my summer office. But there are some things best left for written sentiment and written word, so that would be my first counsel to the president, not that a current president ever asked for counsel from the former presidents, and I'm not sure that this one would really listen to me in any case. But I would advise him to write to the families. I would actually think that that might be more heartfelt and more considerate and give time for the proper statements to be made. That would be my own counsel. Sir, please, I'm delighted to hold the floor and call upon you. What's your name, sir?
Tom DeBlack.
Wonderful to meet you, Mr. DeBlack.
DeBlack.
Wonderful to meet you, sir.
I teach at Arkansas Tech. I've got a question about
Fantastic.
Your...
Fantastic. What do you teach, Professor?
History.
Wonderful. How am I doing so far?
Good.
All right.
In your 1905 visit, I understand that Governor Davis would not dine with you because you were dining with our Reconstruction Governor, Powell Clayton, and Davis said that Clayton's militia was responsible for killing his aunt during Reconstruction. And you are alleged to have said, under your breath, to Clayton, they killed the wrong woman, they should have killed his mother. Can you confirm or deny that?
It's a wonderful vignette. I can neither confirm nor deny based upon my current recollections and my study of the facts, but I think you and I need to have a cup of coffee, Professor. you watch a politician at work. Speaking of coffee, I was at Andrew Jackson's home, the Hermitage. Of course, fine Southern ladies. I begged them. I said, I just need to have a meal at the president's table. They acquiesced and then proceeded to lobby me throughout the luncheon for a new plumbing system to be federally funded, which I included in my subsequent message to Congress. Today you call it the State of the Union, and those monies were allocated by Congress. In any case, when I finished my coffee, I turned to the steward and I said, sir, that coffee was good to the last drop. The coffee was from the Maxwell House Hotel in downtown Nashville, Tennessee. But I mentioned it, for it came to mind with regards to having supper, breaking bread, as we say, and I think in politics that's something that men who disagree with one another should probably be willing to have supper with one another to discuss those disagreements. I come back, though, to the fact that when I toured the South and spoke in the South, I was well welcomed. I may not have won at the ballot box, but I was regarded in part as a fellow Southerner. And you know the validity of my claim. My great-great-grandfather, Archibald Bullock, was the revolutionary governor of Georgia and read the Declaration of Independence, the first man to do so in Savannah. He died the following year, serving at his desk, doing his duty, suspected of being poisoned by British agents. My great-grandfather, Daniel Stewart, was a hero of the South in the Seminole Wars and the War of 1812. My uncle, Jimmy Bullock, who was the head of the Confederate Secret Service in Europe during the war, built the CSS Alabama and the CSS Shenandoah. My uncle Irvine fired the last cannon off of the Alabama in its fateful fight with the Kearsarge. I can prove my Southern roots. When my grandfather, James Stevens Bullock, was a young man and desired to join in matrimony with my grandmother, Martha Stewart, the youngest child of General Daniel Stewart, well, as a lady would do in those days, Miss Stewart declined the proposal. My grandfather didn't have much patience in this issue of matrimony, so he married young Hester Elliott. The following week, my grandmother married Hester Elliott's father, John Elliott, who would go on to serve South Carolina in the United States Senate for 6 years. My grandmother, a wonderful host. In retirement, they returned to Charleston and then settled in Savannah, where Senator John Elliott died. Hester Elliott Bullock died. At that point, my grandfather successfully proposed to my grandmother, and when they married, my grandfather was marrying his stepmother-in-law. If that doesn't make me a Southerner, nothing does. Bullock. Oh, well, anyone else? Oh, please, do, Mr. Powell,
yes,
do stand. I understand you're a representative of the University of the South in Swanton, Tennessee.
Yes, sir, which I believed you called one of the finer institutions of the land.
Of the nation, right? Not a regional university. Of course, my military aide, Archibald Butt, recording much of my later years of my presidency, and Taft's. And I could not have built the Panama Canal without the work of our medical officer, Dr. William Crawford Gorgas. You might have had a little bit of mischief about Gorgas Hall, I would imagine. Yes, Mr. Powell, now that we're on even ground.
Yes,
the floor is yours.
Well, I was going to ask you about your expedition down to Brazil and what is now the River of Doubt.
The River of Doubt, and now you know what they call it, right?
The River of Death?
No.
Theodore.
The real Theodore or the real Roosevelt, if I may, Mr. Powell. Briefly, this was after my presidency. Of course, when I left the presidency, I was but 50 years old. I was younger at that point than all but two men have been prior to me on entering the White House. Still the youngest president in American history when I was inaugurated in September. 42 years and 11 months. President Kennedy is the youngest ever elected, but of course I came to the presidency through the graveyard. In any case, after my presidency, well, there was no presidential pension in those days, Mr. Powell. Congress instituted the presidential pension when they discovered that President Truman and Mrs. Truman were spending their meager savings purchasing envelopes and letterhead and postage to reply to the thousands of congratulatory letters they received on their retirement in Independence, Missouri. So I had to write magazine articles and make speeches in exchange for remuneration. I must admit, I never made Clinton money. But I made pretty good money making speeches, and the South American governments, they invited me to go and make speeches in South America. I agreed to do so. Of course, there was no invitation coming from Colombia, what with Panama and all. But I accepted the invitation, and before I went to South America, the Brazilian government augmented the invitation, asking if I would join Colonel Hondon of the Brazilian Army in exploring a river that 2 years prior, when he and his troops were stretching the first telegraph across the Amazon jungle, he'd discovered the headwaters of a mighty river that appeared on no map of the Brazilian Army, hence the name the Rio de Davido, or the River of Doubt in Portuguese, and in English in that case. So I agreed to go on this expedition. We thought it would be easy peasy, as the kids say these days. We'd hunted for game on the savannah in Africa and thought we would do so in Brazil as well. But the jungle was so dense and the game so scarce, a few snakes and monkeys that disappeared 2 or 3 yards into the foliage. Well, we only found Brazilian nuts but once. And as for fishing in the river, well, it was full of piranha, more likely to eat us than we they. Our provisions were lost into the river. We portaged heavy, dug-out wooden canoes. Every other mile or so, we had to dig a corduroy road through the jungle and push these canoes along. Two Brazilian troopers drowned. Another Brazilian trooper, mad with starvation and fever, found guilty for the second time stealing provisions when we were on quarter rations. He shot and murdered one of his officers and then ran off into the jungle, surely to his own demise, for we were surrounded by tribes that still practiced cannibalism and hunted their human quarry with poison darts. I dashed my leg to the bone trying to save some canoes from being busted up on the rocks, and I developed a malarial fever. Now, I always took with me enough morphine to take my own life in case of a terrible gun accident or a bear mauling. I never wanted to be a fatal burden to my party, and that trip down the River of Doubt was the closest I ever came to taking the poison. For 2 days, I lay in the bottom of a canoe with a 105-degree fever, reciting over and over again a favorite line from Coleridge. In Xanadu did Kubla Khan a stately pleasure dome decree. In Xanadu did Kubla Khan a stately pleasure dome decree. In Xanadu did Kubla Khan a stately pleasure dome decree. Mr. Powell, after 2 days of that, I would have shot me. But my son Kermit, the boy who hunted with me in Africa, he was working for banking and a mining interest in South America. Mrs. Roosevelt had prevailed upon him to join me on the expedition. And Kermit said, Father, I'm going to take you out of this jungle, alive or dead. And it will be marginally easier to do so if you remain alive. With those words, Kermit gave me inspiration to recuperate, to finish mapping our river. And when we completed our excursion, the Brazilian government, after I'd shown the result of my map at the National Geographic Society headquarters in Washington, D.C., the Brazilians renamed that river the Rio Roosevelt, and because it's hard to pronounce, the locals call it the Rio Teodoro. My last chance to be a boy, and I'm delighted for the chance to remember it here with you this evening. All right, short questions, long answers, apparently. Mr. Maughan, right? Please, sir, the floor is yours.
I was wanting to know about your 1902 trip to Mississippi.
Oh, my goodness.
Shooting.
Have you spent some time in the Delta?
A little bit.
All right. I'd been invited to the Delta in 1902 by my friends from Mississippi and Louisiana. Amongst the Louisianans, Colonel John Parker, who would go on to be governor of the Bayou State. In 1916, when I turned down the nomination of the Progressive Party, my prospective running mate was John Parker. Imagine that fusion ticket of a former Republican and a Democrat. There's another contrapositive as to how I might have. But of course, I backed Charles Evans Hughes. I came back into the Republican fold. But on this trip in 1902, another of my friends there was Captain J.A. McElhenney. You might know his lovely little Tabasco pepper sauce. They make it at Avery Island, Louisiana. In any case, the people from Mississippi and Louisiana invited me because back then the big river would flood every spring. And when the waters recessed, new little islands or abutments of land would be created. And Mississippi and Louisiana were arguing about these newly created lands and who had jurisdiction. I was brought down to be the arbitrator of this great controversy. Probably just a good reason to go bear hunting was my thought. Now, we'd been 3 days in the cane breaks of the Mississippi River Delta, and we had not even seen a bear, in great part for the fact that my friends attempted to outdo one another with regards to Southern hospitality. And those of you who are sportsmen or sportswomen, you understand, you can either have a great hunt or a great picnic. You generally cannot have them both at the same time, the same place. I'm sure we scared every bear out of the Delta by that third night. But on that third night, the famous hunting guide, Holt Collier, and if you have students that are doing term papers in history, Holt Collier, a fascinating American, in his youth a slave, during the Civil War, body servant to his master, probably the best shot in the South. During the occupation, he murdered a Union captain in Vicksburg and was acquitted by a sympathetic jury. Holt Collier went on living in Greenville to be the most prolific bear hunting guide in the Delta, over 900 bear to his credit. On the third night that we were in camp, Holt Collier came to camp and he said, "Mr. President, I shall have you a bear by morning if I need to bring it to camp on the end of a rope." We all laughed. The next morning, before dawn, Mr. Collier and I were out early, but we found no trail, no spoor whatsoever, returning to camp. Where later I heard men yelling and dogs barking, someone was blowing a bugle. I raced out from my tent, and there indeed, Mr. Collier had tethered an old wounded male bear to a tree. The bear was greatly wounded on its chest. Hunting dogs had attacked the bear killed two of the hunting dogs. Mr. Collier, wanting to save his prize hunting dogs, but fearing to fire his rifle for fear of harming the dogs, he went into the shallow water in which the bear and the dogs were wrestling, and he broke the barrel of his gun across the bear's head. The bear was bleeding from a great gash and wound on its head. When the bear was dazed by the blow, Mr. Collier tied one end of his lariat around the bear's neck, dove and tied the other end to a tree. And this horrific scene was the scene upon which I came rushing from my tent. My horror compounded when one in my hunting party said, "Mr. President, there's your bear. Go ahead and shoot your bear." What a cowardly thing that would have been to do, to shoot a wounded and tied animal. I refused to do so. I'd founded Boone and Crockett, the nation's first fair hunting and conservation organization, a decade and a half before. Usually a smart student after the story will say, "What happened to the bear?" Well, of course, I refused to shoot the bear, and sometimes the children's story is written to not cause any ill feeling. It says, "Oh, the bear was released out into the swamp." Of course, it's an inhumane thing to release a wounded bear in such pain. Colonel Parker, the aforementioned Democrat from Louisiana, asked Holt Collier for his hunting knife. He went into the shallow water while the bear was tied and stabbed the bear in the heart, which sent the bear into immediate convulsions. I do believe Colonel Parker is still running across the bayou at the current moment for the fright that action put into him. The story, embarrassingly, spread throughout the country. Not exactly my best hunting story. And the cartoonist Clifford Berryman, hearing that story, drew a cartoon of the incident, called it Drawing the Line in Mississippi. The cartoon showed me refusing to shoot a small bear cub tied to a tree. And on this issue, most historians of cartooning believe that the gentleman holding the rope and the black bear cub actually stand by Berryman for the lynch man and the victim of lynching. Interesting to look at the cartoon with those eyes. In any case, after the cartoon was published, the Mictum family of Brooklyn, New York, small toy manufacturers and candy makers, eventually the Ideal Toy Company of New York City. Mrs. Mictum wrote a letter to me asking permission to make a stuffed bear and to name it after me. I wrote back and said, "You may go ahead and do so, but I don't think it will help your sales very much at all." I wonder if any of you have known the love and comfort of what then was called Teddy's Bear. With the apostrophe possessive S, Teddy's Bear? Do any of you still have your teddy bear? Oh, up with your hands, men. Real men have teddy bears. I see some of you ladies have married your teddy bears. That's the way that works. The toy manufacturers, enthused by the sale and the profits of Teddy's Bear, they thought they might equally profit if they made a stuffed animal in honor of each and every subsequent resident of 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, the White House. But I'm afraid, in honor of William Howard Taft and for the toy manufacturers, America's mothers never really took kindly to putting Billy the Possum in with the children at night. The teddy bear reigns supreme. Though I imagine here there's probably a few razorbacks that are in the cribs with the children here, aren't there? Well, right here, if I may, I'm going to come to this gentleman and then right there to you, sir. Maybe. How are you this evening, sir?
I'm good.
Good.
I don't know. Why don't we use this?
Shout it out. I'll repeat it if necessary. They're recording as well.
Oh, maybe a short answer on this one. Are there any recordings of your voice in extant today?
Well done. And the recordings, like the answer, are indeed brief. Thomas Edison in 1913 made recordings of my speeches that were made in 1912. And this voice that you hear right now, sir, bully, is very similar, I think, to what you'll hear online. Now, I've got a friend who's a 1913. And I'm reading indoors. Very unlike the sort of speaking that I would have done at City Park in 1905. Also, an audiologist, he told me that when we listen to something online, that the files are condensed and then expanded. He had the theory and had formulas as to why, that it was playing too fast if you just listened to it. So we slowed it down a little bit, which brought my timbre down a little bit as well.
You are kind of replicating his voice.
I'm Theodore Roosevelt, sir. And now you've got the floor. Remind me your name, sir.
Hank Klein.
Of course, Mr. Klein.
Yes, yes.
K-L-E-I-N.
That's correct.
Good to see the Germans on board. I hope you didn't take any offense about what I said about the Kaiser.
No, not at all.
All right.
The Panama Canal,
yes,
which
sir.
Was started under your administration, is going to be finished soon.
Oh, right.
And as a consumer, I'm wondering, you know, certainly the transportation costs are going to be declining as being able to come through the Panama Canal.
Well done.
Is the government going to raise tariffs, or will our goods actually cost less?
I think Mr. Klein has joined me back in 1903. I think the jury's in on the Panama Canal. The ability to ship our goods and our people much cheaper than we were doing so, shipping down to the railroad line across Panama or going all the way around the Southern Cape or attempting to ship transcontinental here in the United States to begin a trip across the Pacific Ocean. Well, I think the Panama Canal's paid for itself a dozen times over. And as I've traveled the country, celebrating all the good and great things about this country, one of the most difficult presentations I made was in Plains, Georgia, on President's Day, at the Jimmy Carter National Historic Site, with President Jimmy Carter in the audience. Oh, I congratulated the president on the Camp David Peace Accords, right up there with the Treaty of Portsmouth of 1905. I congratulated him on the Anwar National Wildlife Refuge and a wonderful record of conservation. But I just couldn't help myself. The finger came out, and I said, but we've got to talk about the Panama Canal. I was quite earnest. The president laughed, allowing the rest of the audience to laugh. But my goodness, the Panama Canal is and should still be American. Not Panamanian and not Chinese communist operated by a subsidiary of the Chinese communist government. But I think I've gone far afield. If you got me started on the modern manifestation of Bolshevism, I'm looking forward to a day when we can say indeed that Cuba is libre. Well, am I dashing out too quickly ahead of you there? I think I've run out into the Caribbean and you didn't see that coming. Sir, would you please, and I'm looking for the ladies to join the conversation again as well. Delightful.
Mr. President, I heard a story that when you were campaigning, there was an assassination attempt, and yet you kept speaking for over an hour, which I find hard to believe.
You a little worried tonight, doesn't it?
It's incredible if it's true, and I wonder if you would just tell that story.
If I may, this is a highlight of the 1912 campaign, as things go. It was in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, during this month of October. I left the Hotel Gilpatrick in downtown Milwaukee. I ascended an open-air automobile and turned and waved to the enthusiastic crowd outside the hotel. And when I did so, a madman named John Schrank leaned into the automobile and shot me at close range with a .38 caliber. The bullet pierced my overcoat, my folded speech, my steel eyeglass case, and lodged deep into my chest, knocking me down in the automobile in which I was riding. I first stood and made sure that no vigilante justice was done to the madman that shot me. But then, being a hunter and a former soldier, I knew to spit into my palm and to check my spittle. There was no blood in my spittle. My lung was not punctured. It was but a mere flesh wound. I refused medical attention. I demanded to go and make my speech to the thousands awaiting at the auditorium. The automobile took me thither. I climbed upon the stage. I showed the audience my bloody blouse. I said, "You must bear with me. You may not understand. I've just been shot. But it takes more than a bullet to kill a bull moose." And I spoke for 80 minutes with a bullet in my chest. And right now, Ms. Pate is wondering what it's going to take to get me to stop hollering at her guests here this evening. I assure you. Well, Of course, I didn't fare too well in that race in 1912. I won six states, California, Washington, not North Dakota, but South Dakota, Minnesota, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. Gifford Pinchot and his brother Amos bringing me the Keystone State. 27% of the popular vote. But of course, Wilson won in a landslide. And so, unfortunately, there's no contrapositive to this, Mr. McAteer. Many a Republican will still blame me for the 8 years of President Woodrow Wilson. How I wish I could change history. I assure you I would do so. His response to the Germans, we were ill-prepared for the First World War, just as we've been ill-prepared for every war in which we've ever fought. Supplying our soldiers, our Marine, our airmen, all of our soldiers and sailors and the Coast Guard, they should receive every tool which will make their duties more likely to succeed and more likely to preserve their own lives. When I had the opportunity to be the Assistant Secretary of the Navy for about a year, they called me the Warm Weather Secretary. For every time when it would get hot in Washington, D.C., I would encourage the Secretary of the Navy, John Long, to take a long holiday and extra weekends away from the heat and humidity of the swamp. And when he was away, as soon as the door closed, I began operating as if I was in control of the Navy in the pilot house, famously appointing Admiral Dewey to his command of the Asiatic Fleet and ordering him to train the men and the guns to fill up with extra coal and purchase extra colliers, and in case of war with Spain, to locate the Pacific fleet of the Spanish and to engage that fleet, likely in the Philippines. Well, May 1st, 1898, Dewey was the morning on that day, and Dewey were the Regent's eyes, for the Admiral in Manila Bay was Dewey. And we destroyed the Spanish fleet that May 1st, 1898, without the loss of one American ship or one American life in battle. The dividend of preparedness is the saving of American lives. And amongst those 130,000 some lives that were given in Europe, I do believe that many were sacrificed, as was my son, for a lack of preparedness. For Quentin, of whom you've heard earlier, flew in a French Newport plane. We shipped not one plane to Europe in time for the war. The French had the year prior discarded the Newport. It was so inferior by engineering to the German Fokker. But under Wilson, it was good enough for our boys and those who flew with Quentin in the 95th Aero Squadron. If we had been prepared, perhaps Quentin might have survived that July 14th, and perhaps a few more sons of Arkansas might have returned to city and farm here in the state of the Arkansas Traveler. Anyone else? Anyone at all?
Well, I think we've got lots of more questions. I want to take one more.
Oh, delightful. Something tells me that you know that nice lady there.
I might just.
Would you introduce yourself, please?
My name is Leah Lambert, and I work at the Old State House Museum.
Oh, tremendous. Thank you for keeping history alive there.
Yes, you're welcome.
L squared.
My question, I want to hear your thoughts on the two-party system and its effects of the practice and execution of democracy.
You all heard the question, and she's hit me right between the eyes. Are you a hunter?
Yes.
Right, I think you were spot on there. Of course, when I declared my candidacy for the Progressive Party, it was in great part because there wasn't a great difference in the two major parties that controlled Washington, D.C., each under the influences of special interests on Wall Street, men that I called the malefactors of great wealth and the land robbers. And so I was fighting against this corruption that had come from the two parties just exchanging terms of office, exchanging states and territories. Bossism was just as alive in my Republican Party as it was in the Democratic Party. And bossism, of course, is a political operation that pushes people rather than leads them. And so I do believe, though, that if you study my race in 1912, you'll realize that today the ballot access laws are written for the two major parties. Our entire electoral system of being able to get on the ballot and present your program to the people, it favors the democracy in the Republican Party. So I'm a bit of a sacrificial lamb, I think, on the altar of third parties. But I take some hope from President Lincoln and the Republican Party. I was, of course, attracted to the Republican Party in great part because of my father's allegiance to the Union cause and his service as a sanitary commissioner and an allotment commissioner during the war. He saw no way that he could take up arms against his wife's family, but he found ways to serve the Union cause. But now my own Republican Party was just as full of scallywags and thieves as the Democracy. But it was my party, and I did my best to reform the party from within. But of course, I'd given up on that by the time 1912 and the nomination for the Republican Party came in Chicago that summer. Though I'd won 8 of the 12 primaries, Senator Bob La Follette had won 2 of the others. Taft was not popular with the grassroots of Lincoln's Republican Party. But the convention was stolen that summer. And by the way, Ms. Lambert, you know, not the first nor the last time that something politically was stolen in Chicago. But elections really are, I think, something that we would have hope for if there was some sort of wonderful movement of people that didn't consider themselves Republicans or Democrats, Northerners or Southerners, rich or poor, that they might come together and really put America first, not just in rhetoric, but in their hearts and in their deeds. So the possibility of some third party rising and mastering this electoral system, the growth of the internet and the need, as one politician said, that money was the mother milk of politics. Well, that mother's milk is a necessary evil thing, if you think. And I myself wanted to get corporate money out of elections. We passed federal legislation during my administration to remove corporate giving in federal campaigns. And that's been overturned now by the Citizens United Supreme Court decision. I think politics are better without corporate money involved. And I think politics are better if more average people get involved. And I think the two-party structure very often is a rather private party. Oh, the parties will take your vote and they'll take your donation. But I question sometimes whether these great party structures really have concern for the average and ordinary common folk of this country, so many of whom are so disaffected and lack any faith at all in our political system that they've given up on it. Well, giving up is the most un-American of things. I despise it more than the yellow cowardice that Wilson demonstrated. At least Wilson was a man in the arena. Each and every one of us, regardless of party, should be in that arena. And find some way, if the two major parties aren't demonstrating a reason why you should be loyal to either, then get involved in some other effort. A good deal of our elections now are going to a nonpartisan basis. Well, usually I think the voters know who's a Republican and who's a Democrat. But wouldn't it be refreshing if a candidate really could have an equal opportunity and a chance at the local, state, or even the federal level without having to pledge allegiance to a political party that our gut instinct and all that's scientific about political science tells us isn't like what we read in the civic book, but instead it's very often what I experienced in the political convention or in the smoky rooms or in that little part of Fifth Avenue Hotel where Senator Thomas Collier Platt, the boss of the New York Republican Party, held court. They called it the Amen Corner, for all of his yes men simply said, Amen, Amen. There's brighter days ahead, I hope, Ms. Lambert, in part for the fact that you're keeping the history of this community and this state alive. I salute the work that you're doing. It's in the spirit of the Monuments and Antiquities Act, my act in 1906 to try to save American treasures. We saved the Grand Canyon for you. I know conservation, oh my goodness, she's approaching. I know conservation was on your minds this evening. I was only able to wrestle 5 national parks out of Congress. It took an act of Congress to name a national park. And on this issue of the conservation of our natural resources, I was a progressive. And I discovered that very often the opposite of progress was Congress. But 5 national parks, including Crater Lake in Oregon, 150 national forests, 51 bird sanctuaries, and 18 national monuments. Ms. Lambert, the national monuments, and Secretary Zinke's review of recently named national monuments has been in the news. When Congress refused to name the Grand Canyon a national park, I used the powers of the Monuments and Antiquities Act to name the Grand Canyon a national monument. I said Congress would eventually come about its senses. I said it was the one great sight which every American should see. Speaker of the House Joe Cannon, my fellow Republican, who had famously said, not one cent for scenery, after my executive order, Congress turned handsprings in their wrath. And Speaker Cannon said of me famously, President Roosevelt has as much use for the Constitution as a tomcat has for a marriage license. I said the Constitution's made for the people, not for the people, for the Constitution. And if I may, with presidential prerogative, realizing that the evening's probably coming near to conclusion, I made a speech a century ago at the Sorbonne, the University of Paris. The speech is quite famous. It's called Citizenship in a Republic. And Ms. Pate is delighted to know that I shall not recite that speech in its entirety. We began our day in the Oval Office next door. We took a picture next to a portrait of me that was painted that very month of April 1910 by a French artist. I wish to share these words with you, for the students are studying forestry and public service. You are all engaged in good deeds for your community, good deeds for your churches, your temples, your synagogues, good deeds for education, the arts, historic preservation, and more. This is America. No good deed goes unpunished. Certainly no good deed goes without its second guessing, its Monday morning quarterbacking, its criticism. Persist in your good deeds. The Republic needs them now more than ever. And when you are criticized, take heart from the words I shared with the French a century ago and with you here in Little Rock tonight. And it delights me to know that these words are stenciled below decks on the USS Theodore Roosevelt. The Navy calls that great nuclear aircraft carrier the Big Stick. As in the old African proverb I was wont to quote, speak softly and carry a big stick, you will go far. I share these words of encouragement with you. Persist in your good deeds and remember, it is not the critic who counts. Not the man who points out how the strong man stumbled or where the doer of deeds could have done better. The credit belongs to the man and today to the woman who's actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes up short again and again, because there is no effort without error or shortcoming, but who knows the great devotions, the great enthusiasms, who spends herself in a worthy cause, and who in the end, at the best, knows the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least he fails while daring greatly, that his name shall never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat. Good citizens, we've all known victory, we've all known defeat. We're all human, we all prefer the former over the latter. But to explain to Ms. Pate the reason I made the remarks I do with the children this morning, I told them the story of my overcoming my asthma as a young boy and building my body and perhaps overdoing it a little bit. I told them the story of the tragedy of my young life, losing my father when I was away at Harvard, losing my wife and mother on the same day when I was a young man of two different diseases beneath the same roof. I ran for the mayorship of New York when I was a young man. I came in third out of three. In any of these cases, what if I'd given up on living the strenuous life just because I was a weak and sickly boy? What if I'd thought of myself as an invalid instead of being the great sportsman? What if as a young man I'd allowed those terrible twin tragedies that befell me to limit and define and envelop my life, and instead going to the Badlands and through the hard work in the outdoors, ranching and hunting, getting back into the family way, 17 grandchildren. Well, what if I'd given up on life and politics and public service after that humiliating defeat running for the mayorship in my home city? I would have never been your president, fighting for the square deal. The reason, by the way, Mr. Powell, that the artist got some borglum says, I'm atop Mount Rushmore with the other three. Have you seen me at Mount Rushmore? Oh, don't bother, I'm rather stone-faced there. But here at the Clinton Library, and because of the kindness of everyone here and the wonderful kindness of Stephen Mackett here and all of those board members and the taxpayers of the city who've assisted me to come back and visit Little Rock, I thank you for keeping history alive and ask each and every one of you to remember the highest office in the land is not president, it is citizen. And how each and every one of us stand up and fares our share, a fair share of the load in the duties of citizenship, that'll get us through whatever challenges we've got. Live up to the calling of the scouts, leave your campground cleaner than you found it, and live up to the duties of being a good citizen of this blessed republic. Thank you all so very, very much. Thank you. Fuller. Thank you, sir. Nice. Oh, thank you kindly. Fuller. Thank you very much, Mr. Allen. Thank you, Mr. Leibniz. Thank you so very, very much. Thank you, Carmen. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. All right, all right. You can't fool me. I can tell when I've kept an audience on their seats too long. So what we'll do, we'll take a brief break and then we'll start the second half of the program. Have a wonderful evening. God bless Little Rock. Bully.
Yay, team. I'll say it.
Yeah.